The following program you're about to see is from what has been hailed as the golden age of television, which basically was television of the 1950s. During this time, the staple of television was live television drama. Many programs like Studio One, U.S. Steel Hour, Kraft Television Theater, Playhouse 90, to name a few, brought entertainment into America's homes during the prime time live. This means that once the cameras were turned on, it was up to the actors and crew to be as perfect as possible for the next hour, because there were no retakes, no stopping the cameras. The show had to go on. The viewing public was seeing the show right as it was happening. This, however, has resulted in a loss of our television history with regard to archival purposes. Since many of these shows were performed live before the advent of videotape, they are preserved on an inferior film format that has lost the appearance of a live television performance. The following is a cleanup and motion restoration of a performance that was captured on film for rebroadcast. The result is a near as possible restoration to what the original live broadcast would have looked like nearly 60 years ago. For a comparison of the filmed archive of this program to the restored copy, you can skip to the end of the video for comparison footage. But to demonstrate the difference, let's do it with modern technology. This is basically what live television would have looked like during its first 15 to 20 years. A 30 frame per second black and white standard definition signal, or at that time it was called high definition. But really there wasn't a lot of film content, so everything had what we now call the soap opera effect. It just looked like everything was a soap opera, or if we were watching it now. But really, the drama of the performance was that you're watching it as it's happening. And it was all made possible in the late 40s by a very special camera, television camera, designed by RCA, called the Image Orthicon camera. And what it did was it allowed a studio, a television studio, which in previous generations had to have massive amounts of light, and the lights were hot and overheated the actors and melted things on the stage. The Image Orthicon filmed with much lower light levels and a much wider range, but there was a trade-off. In that wide range, you had a narrow place to work with, and anything that overloaded the camera would show up as a bloom or a dark halo around the screen. Here we have a light or something reflecting. It didn't really matter. It could reflect off the studio lights or regular light. It's overloading the camera's light setting, so within that range. And you'll see that very commonly with this type of camera. But nevertheless, it was so revolutionary and made television much easier to produce that they named an award after it. And we see this award every year. It's called the Emmy Awards. They changed the letters in it a little bit. But they were originally going to call it the Emmy Awards after the Image Orthicon because it made that much of an important impact on making television possible. The other problem they had to address at this time was time zones. And it really wasn't as easy as we think today, because every time zone sees its own programming at the appropriate time. However, the best solution, since television was live and there was no videotape, was there were two performances. There was a performance for the East Coast and a performance for the West Coast. And this obviously got tiring for actors, and eventually a solution was devised in the late 40s again. It was the kinescope. And a kinescope is a very basic device. It's a television monitor, a specialized television monitor, with a 16 millimeter camera pointed at that television monitor, running at a frame rate of 24 frames per second. Not 30 frames, but 24 frames per second. And so as a result, most of the television that we watch today that was live, we're not seeing what it actually looked like. We're seeing a film copy of the show that was taken from a television screen. And those copies were printed at a very rapid pace. 3 hours later, those copies were broadcast to the West Coast. So the West Coast would always see a kinescope copy. From day one, kinescopes were considered to be inferior. And there had been efforts since the early 1950s, at the very least, to produce a videotape device, or as they would have called it, a tape device like audio tape, but for video. It eventually came along in 1956, but not into full practice until about 1958. As a result, most of the television programs that are live exist on Kinescope. And even after videotape came out, the practice of wiping tapes is only practicality. Of course, you can wipe a videotape and reuse it. And so the Kinescope was used to archive programs, and the videotape was used for rebroadcasts, for time delay rebroadcasts. So even then, still, a lot of programming is on Kinescope. Now, through the process of motion restoration and the cleanup of the film, we can take an original film print, clean up the dirt and dust and grain on the film, and then apply a motion restoration software to it, which restores the motion back to its original 30 frame per second broadcast rate. And it makes it look about 90% of what it was when it was originally broadcast. So, in short, we're taking a film copy of a program and bringing it back to what it looked like the day it was broadcast. You'll essentially be seeing what people would have seen in the studio on the monitors or from a videotape copy if it had existed. The story you're about to see is from a program that represented the pinnacle of live television, Playhouse 90. Every night, every Thursday night at 9:30, CBS would offer a 90-minute drama performed live from Television City. Requiem for a Heavyweight was the second episode in the first season of this series and is partially responsible for establishing Playhouse 90 as the pinnacle of a live television drama. Due to the lack of program content being available in its entirety, the opening and end credits and commercials have been inserted from existing Playhouse 90 videotapes, so that you may experience the pace of the show. The only missing portion is at the beginning, with the customary introduction of the performers before the sponsors are listed. Written by Rod Serling, Requiem for a Heavyweight won Playhouse 90 five Emmy Awards for Best New Program Series, Best Single Program of the Year, Best Single Performance by an Actor for Jack Palance, Best Direction for Ralph Edwards, and Best Teleplay for Writing by Rod Serling. It is today considered to be one of the finer examples of live television. And now, for the first time in 60 years, you can see it as it would have looked on the television screen the evening it was broadcast. The clocks are turned back, and it's now the evening of October 11th, 1956. Enjoy.
Live from Television City in Hollywood. Playhouse 90. Playhouse 90, brought to you by Camel, far and away the world's largest selling cigarette today. Rich in flavor, mild to smoke. Have a real cigarette. Have. And by your gas company in cooperation with gas producers, pipeline companies, and gas appliance and equipment manufacturers who bring the modern miracles of gas service to your home. And by Allstate, company with more than 4 million policyholders who have discovered that you're in good hands with Allstate.
Today, more people than ever are doing the laundry with gas.
Take gas, for example. Set the control and automatically you have instant heat. In a gas dryer, clothes are fluff dried in low heat, high airflow action that's so gentle, it's safe even for the most delicate fabrics. For safety, speed, and economy, you should have a dryer in your home.
Thank you. the seventh round, young Jack Stubbins.
It was Gibbons, TKO. Get this, the seventh round. Yeah. I don't know what kept the mountain up, but he lasted seven. No. Don't worry, Mr. Henson. I'm waiting on Mace now. He'll pay. Right.
How about it? Can you make it, Mal? Can you make it?
Hey, how are you, Mace? I want to talk to you.
What about?
Money. Our money.
Arnie, take him over there for a minute, will you? I'll be right with you.
Two words. Cough up.
Look, I'll get it, see? You tell him I'll get it. Tell him to phone me.
Mr. Henson's no collection agency.
Look, I know it, but tell him I'll get it, will you?
So I told him, and he says I got it.
So what'd he say?
He says I got it.
Cut ice?
Well, with him. I look at this guy, and I put it to him straight. Did you ever see a guy walk in a ring with a busted hand?
So what'd he say? Cut ice?
Nah, I gotta put him in next Thursday.
What happened to him?
Well, don't get impatient, Jock. It's a fast track out there tonight. You ought to see the other guy. Not Mark on him. How is he?
This wasn't the night, that's for sure.
You can say that again.
Requiem for a heavyweight. Directed by Ralph Nelson. Produced by Martin Manulis.
Martin. Martin, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Give me some of that alum, will you?
Oh, alum, I don't think alum will fix that. I think that'll take stitches.
Yeah, keep getting wider and wider. I've seen him cut before, but never like this.
The doc will be here in a minute. Mace. He'll fix it.
Yeah.
Hey, Mace.
Take it easy, kid.
Mace.
A lot of time.
Too fast. Much too fast.
Yeah, it was a bum night all around, kid. There'll be others.
Yeah, sure. Others.
Mace. Mace, take care by the belt. It hurts.
Oh, that's just a little rope burn. It'll be all right, Ma.
It hurts.
Hold on. Haven't you had enough yet?
It's his eye, Doc.
His eye. Hey, now, let me breathe, will you? Where do you buy your cigars, Mace? I see they condemn the store.
Hey, you going out this week, Doc?
Let me see. This is Wednesday, I leave Friday.
Vacation?
Vacation? Retirement. 38 years. I'm the only one to walk out of the ring without wobbling.
38 years
and retiring. 38. Here, give me a swab, will you? My wife says I've been in so long, I ought to write a book. Yeah, who'd buy it?
Yeah, I bet you've seen some good ones, huh, Doc?
Good ones, bad ones, live ones, couple of dead ones. And almost dead ones. He's got no business in there, Mace. You hungry, is that it?
What do you mean, hungry? Well, he was number five in 1948.
Only in 1948. Well, I've seen a lot of them in 38 years. When I first came in, they used to lay them out in front of me. They were human beings then, young men. You know what it's like now, Mace? Army. It's like a guy grading meat in a packing plant. They roll the carcasses down the line in front of him, and he stamps them. Beef. Look here, Mace. Now look at his pupil. You see, that's known as sclerotic damage. You see that tissue? A couple of good solid rights to that eye, and you can get him a seeing eye dog. Or maybe it won't happen to have it that way. Maybe some night he'll bang his head on the bathroom door and bleed to death. Either way, Mace, could happen either way. No more. Mountain and I will both retire this week.
What do you mean?
No more. He's through.
Paul, I could let him rest up. I got nothing scheduled for him.
He can rest up for the rest of his life.
What are you talking about? He spends 14 years in the ring, suddenly gets a little cut, and you're going to put him out the pasture?
Suddenly. It doesn't go 14 years, and then suddenly. There's never one cut. It's 14 years of cuts. Yeah, write me a book all about my gladiator friends. You, too, can become pathological in 38 years of relatively easy lessons.
Joker, big joker.
Joker? Who's laughing?
Doc here?
He left.
My head hurts, Mace.
I bet it does, kid. No, no.
It's deep, huh, Mace?
It's deep enough. You could stick your wallet in it. Now, take it easy, kid. Take it easy. Just rest a minute, then you can take a shower.
No, I'll be all right now. Oh, Lordy, I caught it tonight, Mace. What did I do wrong?
You aged, kid. That's the trouble, you aged.
What do you mean, aged? Don't everybody age?
Yeah, everybody ages, kid. Go on, take a shower. It'll do you good.
Yeah.
Try not to get that tape wet.
What are you going to do, Mace?
I don't know. Maybe I'll cut my throat.
Something's wrong, isn't it?
Where were you when the lights went out? I just lost a boy. Get with it, Army.
Besides that,
nothing. Well, you mean that guy out there? I owe him 50 cents for a raffle ticket. I just mean I gotta start hunting and pecking around. I gotta find me a new boy. Maybe I'll try me a lightweight this trip.
You work fast, Mace.
Well, I gotta eat. Are you something different?
I'm not the one looking for a job. 5 minutes after
I
get
word. I'm looking for a job for you, too. Just remember that, Boy Scout.
Oh, I was just wondering.
Well, you want out, Army? You got a million offers, huh?
No, I didn't mean anything.
All right, cut the whole big deal. I know you're good. I know you're one of the best cut men in the city. You could take your pick. I don't know why you haven't left before this.
Oh, never mind me. What about the mountain?
Well, I don't know. He'll find something.
He was good, Mace. He had everything that was needed. He had hands, legs, brains. He could take a cannonball in the face, and I could fix him up with a wet towel.
Yeah, he was good, all right. Oh, brother, where am I going to find another one like him?
Hey, Army! Hey, bathrobe, huh? Feel pretty good now, Mace. Well, I feel a lot better. My head still hurts, and my eye feels kind of funny, but yeah, I'll be all right now. I got a lot of spring yet left in my legs, Mace, huh? How about it, Army? Still there, huh?
Hey, Mountain!
Yeah, Mace.
Sit down, will you, kid?
Sure, Mace, sure.
Well, the doc looked you over.
Yeah? Oh, yeah, I thought he was here. I wasn't sure, though. You know, I was still a little groggy yet, you know.
Yeah, I know. Well, the doc looked you over good this time.
Yeah?
Yeah, he figures you've had it.
What did you say, Mace?
I said the doc says you've had it. No more. You gotta leave now.
Leave where?
Lay it out for him, will you, Army? Look, Mountain, the doc says you've had it. He says no more. Says you gotta leave now.
Leave? You, Mesh. Mesh, it's crazy. That's crazy.
All right, so it's crazy. So maybe I think it's crazy. But you heard what the doc said. Go argue with the commission. You all packed up in here, Army.
Mesh?
Yeah, kid.
Well, what'll I do?
Well, I don't know. You do whatever you want to do. Anything you like. It's as easy as that.
No. I mean, a guy's got to do something.
Well, so do something. Do anything you like.
Yeah, but Mesh, I don't know anything but fighting. You know, I'm 14 years a pro. You know, Mesh, I'm with you 14 years.
And before that?
Well, before that what? Who remembers?
Why don't you go back home to Tennessee, man? You're always talking
about
it.
Well, I was back there.
Well?
I haven't been back there all these years. I wouldn't know anybody. Nobody would know me. Mesh, we could try another state.
Oh, now look, if you don't pass muster in New York State, you can't pass muster anyplace else. You know that.
Hey. How about some club fights?
Mountain, you know there haven't been club fights like that since John L. Sullivan. You know that.
Want me to help you dress, Mountain?
No. So I can dress myself. Mesh?
Yeah, kid.
Mesh, I'm sorry about tonight. I'm sorry I lost.
Well, that's okay, kid. Why don't you give another thought?
Keep these now. A little later on, you and I can go over to the hotel, you know, and we'll talk this out. You know, we'll make some kind of plans,
yes,
huh?
Sure, I'll be sure.
What do you say, Mesh? I just seen slaughter on 10th Avenue.
Breaks your heart, don't it, Mr. Pirelli?
Was there enough left to sew together? Well, look, I got my own troubles, too. You can stop the debt in my racket, you know. But believe me, there ain't that much grief. They're gonna take the skin off you, buddy.
Come on, I'll buy you a drink.
What now?
I don't know. Maybe I'll shadow box my way up a cliff. Come on, I need that drink.
I'll wait for the kid.
Kid? Yeah, that's what I always call him, kid. When we make our big mistake, just because they got on shorts and gloves, we call them kids. They're all men, Army. The oldest. See you later.
Today, more people than ever are cooking with gas. And here's Julia Mead to show you why.
Hello. You know, there's no need for matches in a kitchen with a modern gas range, because the ovens of today's automatic gas ranges are self-lighting. You just turn this dial, and the oven is lit. And today's gas ovens cook whole meals by remote control. For example, you just pop your meal into the oven, set the automatic clock control. Then while you're shopping or at the movies, the oven goes on automatically. Later, when the food is cooked just the way you want it, the oven goes off automatically. And you never have to open the door of this modern gas range to tell whether your roast is done. A built-in meat thermometer placed in the roast registers here on this dial. Now, if you like an open-fire barbecue, here is an all-weather way to get it, with the open flame of an up-to-date gas broiler. There's never a need for open doors when you broil with gas. Flame itself consumes all the broiler smoke and vapors. Also, gas gives you thermostatically controlled top burners for perfect, carefree meals automatically. And gas costs less to buy, install, and use. So visit your gas company or gas appliance dealer and find out firsthand why today more people than ever are cooking with gas.
So he comes in.
Yeah, go ahead.
So he comes in. Now, I size him up. He throws a left. I duck. He throws another left. I duck. And then he throws another left.
You duck.
I don't duck. I take it smack on the chin. I'm down. Oh, brother, my darling. But I get up, listen. I get up, but I stop.
Two beers, Tommy.
How did you do, Mountain?
Not so good, Charlie. But I almost went the route, though. Doc says I'm over the hill now.
That's too bad. So, now you can join the regular Wednesday evening coffee clutch. I'm getting tired of the same old stories. You can bring me up to date. Yeah. Everyone on the house. This is the only one in the house that ain't watered.
Thank you, Charlie.
To Mountain McClinic, 111 fights.
He wasn't no good, but he never took a dive.
Let's get a booth.
Hi, boy, how you doing?
I'll tell you when we get a booth.
Well, take it easy, Bub. That's my manager.
What'd you do with your dough, Mountain?
You mean?
The dough you got for the fight. You got $633. Where is it?
Well, it's mostly gone, Mace. You know, I owe the hotel half of it.
But where's the other half?
Well, I guess I got some.
Don't get cute with me. This is Mace. I asked you a question. Don't you have any money at all?
Yeah, I got some. Yeah, here. It's 20, it's 40, 55, 56, 57. I got $58, Mace.
$58?
What's the matter, Mace? Are you in hock?
Heavy.
How much?
How about $3,000?
Gee, Mace, that's a lot of money. How are we going to get it?
I don't know, but I ain't got much time.
How did you ever get in a crack like that?
Oh, you don't know, huh? Hey, you remember last month when you hurt your hand, you was in the hospital?
Wait, that comes off the top. What are you giving
me? I got a specialist, didn't I? That money come out of my own pocket. And how much do you think that cost? More than my cut, I'll tell you.
Gee, I didn't know.
It's all right. Look, I'm not complaining. The dough goes, you know. One-third of your cut ain't much lately. But don't even cover expenses. So I've been filling in for you out of my own pocket.
Mace, you know, maybe I could get a job, kind of tide us over.
Sure. Hey, Jake Green's been touting the lightweight. Maybe we could buy a piece of him. With what? We could buy his thumb. This I could afford.
We get a new boy, Mace?
Not yet a while, Mountain. That's just an idea.
Oh, I see. I see. You know, I remember first night I come in here. Mace, I remember a guy's name even, Shipsky. Morty Shipsky. I knock him out in the first round. You in the army, you stood up in the bar and you shouted. You shouted, everybody take a drink on Harlan McClintock, the next champ. You remember?
I remember.
Sure, you asked me where I was from and I said I lived on a mountain in Tennessee. That was the night Mace here says that's what we'll call you. We'll call you Mountain. How many nights we come in here, Mace? How many
lots
nights?
Of them.
Sure, a couple of hundred, I guess. Couple of hundred nights. We just sit around here and talk about this fighter or that fighter by the hours.
Look, it's just a break, kid. That's all. Just the breaks.
You know, all of a sudden, I feel like I come on the outside looking in. I feel like I don't belong with you guys anymore.
Oh, listen, Mountain.
Sit down.
It's no way at all. What did you say, Mountain? Oh, nothing on me. Nothing. Look, I'll see you guys later. I'm gonna take a walk.
How did you lose the dough?
How do you think?
You bet against him, didn't you?
Something like that.
You don't sidestep very good.
You want to clear it?
A little bit.
I said he wouldn't go three.
Oh, big disappointment, eh?
There's a better way. Gibbons, 18 fights, 18 wins. He's got a lit fuse in each fist. And they match him against a Mountain.
They match him?
Well, did I? I just go through the motions. You know, a good crowd pleaser, they said. A couple of real good draws in the Pier 6. Highland Mountain McClintic, ex-leading heavyweight contender. X is right, very X. 8 years X.
What's a good word, Mage?
Blow, that's the good word. I'm busy.
How do you know what I'm selling?
Pitch, I'm busy.
Mr. Henson sent me. Now you pitch. Tell me when Mr. Henson can expect this dough.
Soon?
How soon is soon?
3 weeks.
You said two, didn't you?
2 weeks.
You dropped something, Mr. Loomis. I'll be seeing you.
These guys play for real, you know what I mean, Army? This ain't no bank transaction. If I welsh, you can take a spoon and scrape what's left of me off a wall and put it in a cup. That's how they look on bets.
Who told you to bet?
Who told me I had to eat?
Well, my goodness me, you picked the sport.
Sport. It was headroom in Holman sewers. What am I going to do, Army?
What is the Mountain going to do?
You tell me. He asked me. He sits there and he says to me, what am I going to do, Mish? He asked me what he's going to do. What am I supposed to be, the book of knowledge or something? I'm supposed to tell him what to do? I don't know what to tell him to do. I'm so scared, Army.
Oh, stop it, stop it. You lost the bankroll and the meal ticket. But this poor beat-up kid, did you ever stop to think what he lost tonight?
Don't you think I feel sorry for him, Army? I don't want to hurt the kid. I remember him like he was. I remember how he looked the first day he walked in my office. His whole hands and feet, mouth full of teeth, and he talked like General Lee.
You're talking about memories. You remember Christmas, 1945, right at this table? You remember that? We had $6 between us. Four of them you spent on a beefsteak and a new tie for him.
Oh,
you remember that?
Tie. He worked over nothing left.
I remember lots of times like that. That night up in Hazleton, Pennsylvania, when that big Swede knocked him out. You remember that? They took him to the hospital that night. I remember standing out in the corridor waiting with you. You cried that night, Mace.
All right, knock it off.
All right, I will. But I want you to hear something right now. I'm telling you, Mace, I love this guy like he was part of my own flesh. And I figure if I don't worry for him and weep for him, nobody else will, least of all you, for some reason. So be careful. That's what I'm telling you now, Mace. Be careful.
Take it easy. Take it easy. The word didn't end tonight. Remember that.
The world didn't end just because you left the ring. It didn't end for you either. Come on.
Mace? Mace, would you kind of stick around a little bit? You know, I could always depend on you, Mace. I always needed to depend on you.
Sure, Jim.
Now a word from our alternate sponsor of this portion of the show, Bristol-Myers.
A totally new idea developed by Bristol-Myers. A remarkable new deodorant. Remarkable new Ban deodorant. The first deodorant to roll on is now first in sales because Ban rolls on protection that stays on. Ban checks perspiration, stops odor round the clock.
More effective than messy creams, easier to apply than drippy sprays. Not a crumbly stick.
Ban rolls on. This revolving marble rolls on just the right amount of protection every time. Ban may be imitated, but it can't be duplicated because Ban's applicator is patented.
And Ban is safe for normal skin. Can't harm delicate fabrics either.
Ban is now first in sales because Ban rolls on protection that stays on. Now available in two sizes.
This is the CBS Television Network. We now return to Playhouse 90. This half hour brought to you by Allstate Insurance Company.
You look fine. Don't worry, you look great.
What do I say, Army?
What do you mean, what do you say? You just go in and tell her you want a job. That's all. It's very simple.
Army, the past few days, I've been 35 places already. You know, some of these jokers won't even let me in the door.
Oh, it's different here.
Yeah.
Mr. McClintock, please. Yeah.
That's me. That's me.
In here, please, Mr. McClintock.
I can't go in there with you. I'll stay here at ringside. I can't go in and fight for you. Go ahead.
Sit down, Mr. McClintock.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I was just wondering...
Oh, I beg your pardon.
You were going to say?
I was just wondering if my friend could come in.
Is he looking for employment, too?
No, not exactly, but he's kind of my handler.
I beg your pardon?
No, that's all right. He stay out there.
Sir Harlan McClintock, your age is...
33.
Place of birth?
Kennesaw. Oh, that's in Tennessee.
Oh, I see. Your education... Mr. McClintock, you've left that blank here.
My education? Oh, you mean school?
That's right.
In ninth grade.
Then you left, is that it?
Yeah, then I left.
Now, field of interest. What do you like to do?
Almost anything. Anything at all.
Past employment record, Mr. McClintock. You have nothing written down there. Who've been your past employers?
Well, you see, I haven't had any past employers. I mean, like you mean down here on this paper. I've been kind of on my own. Except you might say I've been working for Mesh.
Mesh?
Yeah, you know, all I've been doing 14 years is fighting.
Fighting?
You know, in a ring.
A professional prize fighter?
Yeah. Yeah, you catch on. Yeah, professional prize fighter. I mean, a heavyweight.
Sounds like interesting work, Mr. Flynn.
Well, it's a living. Look, I don't want you to go to any trouble. You know, Army said to tell you that anything you got, Jake, with me, dishwashing, anything.
Let's see if we can't examine something else, Mr. McClintock. Something you might like even more. How about factory work?
Well, I never worked in a factory. No, I don't think I'd know anything about that.
No sort of assembly line work? Blueprint reading? Anything like that? Anything in sales? There's a lot of openings in that sort of thing now. Department store work, anything like that?
I couldn't do anything like that. I couldn't sell anything. You know, with my face, I'd scare the customers away.
You know, I don't want to take up your time. Well, the only reason I'm here is because Army said I should come. You know, I've been answering all these ads, and I'm getting no place at all. Mace needs a dough real bad, and I can't do nothing for him anymore, and I gotta, you know, I gotta get a job, I gotta get something.
Mr. McClintock.
You know, a guy goes along 14 years, all he does is fight, once a year, twice a year, and prelims, semifinals, finals, and what's he supposed to do? They tell him he's through, what's he supposed to know how to do except fight? You know, they got poor Mace tied up by the ears, and I gotta do something for him.
Mr. McClintock, we handle a lot of placements here. I'm sure we'll be able to find something for you.
Yeah, I know, but I don't fit in all these holes here. I mean, like this question here. Why did you leave your last job? State the reason.
Oh, that's question 9. Well, you see, Mr. McClintock, what that means.
Well, I know what it means. But what do I write down? What do I write down that would make any sense? I left my last job because I got hit so much I was on my way to Punchyland, and I'd probably go blind.
Punchyland?
Sure. You fight so long, you walk around on your heels, listen to the bells. Nadine, that's what happens to you. The doc looks at my eyes, he says, one or two more fights, I might go blind. You know, it's just a bum break, that's all. It's just not fair. You know, in 1948, they ranked me number 5. I'm not kidding you, number 5. You know, it wasn't any easy year either. There was Charles, Walcott, and Lewis is still around. And they had me number 5. You know, Mace said that if
Mace,
I got a break...
Mace, who's Mace, Mr. McClintock?
Well, Mace is my manager. And what does it do to him? You know, it's a fine thing to do to a guy who kept you going 14 years. You just stopped cold on him. So it's just a bum break. It's just not fair at all. Well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to blow up like that. You ought to throw me out of here. I'm sorry.
That's perfectly all right, Mr. McClintock. As long as you've got your address down here, we'll contact you if anything comes up.
Yes, sure, I know.
Right after the war, I did a lot of work with disabled veterans. You know, wounded men who had to make a new...
Yeah, go on.
I meant you'd be surprised that the different kinds of openings that come up for...
Cripples. For guys like that?
I didn't mean just that. I meant for people who have special problems.
But I got no special problems. You see, there wasn't any room down on that sheet, but I was almost a heavyweight champion of the world. I'm a big, ugly slob, and I look like a freak, but I was almost a heavy... You know, I'd like to put that down on that piece of paper. This is no punk. This is a guy who is almost a heavyweight champion of the world.
Hurt your head, Miss Richard?
Yeah, sure it hurts. But I'm getting used to it. You know, it's getting like an old friend. Every punch you take for 14 years, you just slough it off because it's part of the bill you pay going up. But after that, all those punches, they start to hurt. They hurt sometimes like you want to scream. You know, you paid the bill. For nothing.
Mr. McClintock! Mr. McClintock, I think we'll be able to find you something that you'll like. Just give us time.
Something that I like? Well, you do that, miss, because I don't want very much. You see, all I want's a heavyweight championship of the world. That's all.
How about another game of cards?
Don't do me any favors, will you?
Here, it's over here. Huh? It's over here, what you looking for. If that was an inch shorter, you'd smoke your nose.
Does that hurt you? What are we going to do, Arnie?
Ask him for another week.
Ask him. You think that's going to cut any ice with them? They want their dough.
Hello. Oh, yeah. Would you please tell him I'd like to talk to him when he comes in?
No, I don't want to talk to you. I want to talk to Mr. Pirelli himself.
That's right.
Well, you want to lodge a complaint, you look it.
Pirelli handles wrestling.
What, is that a big secret?
What do you want with a wrestling promoter?
You got the longest nose in the business.
You're going to answer me?
Okay. I figured just for kicks, we'll let the kid wrestle a few.
Knock him out?
Well, sure, why not? It pays real good. It pays almost as good as they pay actors. I'll work out a routine for him, you know. We'll make him something, like Gorgeous George, the Mad Baron. We'll bill him as Harlem and Clinic, the Mountaineer. Then I'll get one of them Mountaineer outfits, you know, with a black hat and a long squirrel gun. Well, it's money, ain't it?
It's money, sure, but what kind of money?
What difference does it make what kind it is?
This kind of guy don't take getting laughed at.
What are you talking about, this kind of guy? What is he? A prima donna all of a sudden? All of a sudden he's sensitive? All of a sudden he's fragile like a piece of precious china or something? Since when does a guy like this get so sensitive all of a sudden?
Since when? Since we knew him, not since when. You never see things like that, Mage.
Maybe you ain't got the time. Do you ever think of that? Maybe I'm so busy stitching him up so he can make a show on the next week. Maybe I'm on the hands and knees to some promoter so we can use them and get some groceries?
Hey, Mace, you stink.
Yeah, I stink. And you want to know who owes who? Okay, look at the records. Look at the win and the loss. I figure Mountain comes out at the short end. He owes me. It's as simple as that. And what do I ask him to do? Put on a costume and make a few people laugh for a couple of minutes? Is that going to curdle his sensitive insides?
He only has one thing left, Mace. That's his pride. You don't want to job that off. He was a somebody. Let it go at that. Don't turn him into a geek.
All right, so I sell his sensitive soul in the street. So weep for him. So rip your clothes a little. So I'll take an inch off his pride, but by everything holy, he and I have a full gut to show for it. You can starve, wise guy.
Yeah. Willie Kaiser. He comes out of Philadelphia. He's a lightweight.
He never was a lightweight. He always fought middle. I remember him well.
Middleweight you are. The weight of 135 pounds in his life.
Well, get on with your story. What happened?
Well, he comes out in the fourth round real slow, just like he always does.
Yeah, he always came out slow.
I'm sorry, miss. Unescorted ladies on permit. I was looking for Mr. McClintock. The man that said I'd find him here. The mountain, you mean? That's it. He touches me a couple times on the forehead. I back off, you see. He comes at me. Now, I want him to leave. Now, this guy got to let lead because he's the best counterpuncher in the business.
Oh, boy, he could always counterpunch, right? Yeah. Man, could that guy counterpunch. I'll never forget one time in Chicago. It was around the fourth round.
Come on, go ahead.
I was going
ahead,
in. Go ahead.
That's how he takes fire like that, all through the round.
Yeah.
He don't hurt me, and I don't hurt him.
Miss Carney, what are you doing here?
Well,
Do you want to sit down by the table?
A friend of mine and I had dinner over at McCleary's. It isn't very far from here. And she got a headache and went on home.
Yeah.
Well, I remembered you giving me your hotel and...
Well, it was nice of you to look me up.
I've never been around here before.
There's no change. If you're here once, you've seen it all.
Atmosphere.
Yeah, you might call it atmosphere. Well, that goes on all the time around here. Mace says this part of the room is the graveyard, and these guys spend their time dying in here, you know, fighting their lives away inside their heads. That's what Mace says.
It's pretty sad.
Yeah, I suppose it is.
I've got a confession to make. I didn't eat at McCleary's. I ate at home. I came here on purpose. I asked for you at your hotel. I've been thinking a lot about you, Mr. McClintock. I was just wondering...
Yeah, go ahead.
I was just wondering if you ever thought of working with children.
What?
Work with children, you know, in athletics.
Well, I never given much thought.
Do you like children?
Children? Well, I never had anything to do with them. But I always liked them. Yeah, I liked him a lot. Why, you're thinking of summer camp, something like that?
That's right, that sort of thing. You know, in a month or so, there'll be a lot of openings. And I was thinking, well, perhaps you ought to give that some thought.
Yeah, but they're going to have to look at me and listen to me talk.
Why not? Look, you've got to begin someplace. You've got to give it a try.
Sure, I got to. Why did you come here tonight?
I've been thinking about you. I want to help. If I can. How about it, Mr. McClintock? Could I have a beer?
A beer? You mean here?
I kind of like it here.
Sure. Hey, Charlie. Charlie. Would you bring a couple of beers over a table? I'm sorry, sure, bud.
Okay, Pally.
Excuse me.
How about some music?
What?
Don't you like to listen to music when you drink beer?
Music? Hmm? No, I never give them much thought. Oh, sure, we can play music.
Hey, Mountain, play My Heart Tells Me, huh?
Hey, Charlie, hey, how about a glass for the lady?
Antique man?
That's pretty.
Yeah, that is pretty. Them are violins.
Beautiful.
I never had much to do with music, you know. I never had much time.
What is that?
Well, it's just music. It's just plain old music. You know, I never knew any music really by heart except the national anthem. Because they play it before every fight, the national anthem. And then there was Smiley Collins.
Who's Smiley Collins?
Well, he used to fight it, but he used to play a violin. It's funny, isn't it? He was a fighter. He used to play a violin.
He used to play a violin. Seriously?
You're real serious. Well, I don't know anything about a violin, you know, but man, that boy, you know, he had a right hand like dynamite. He could knock a wall down with his right hand. I remember one time he was fighting a guy named Floyd, Willie Floyd. Floyd had 20 pounds on him. So Smiley comes out. Well, Charlie, You keep a change. They don't have many ladies in here. That's why you forgot about the glasses.
Thank you.
Drink hearty. That's what Mace always says. Drink hearty.
Drink hearty. Drink hearty, Mr. McClintock. You think a lot of Mace, don't you?
Oh, yeah. He's number one. He's a real great guy.
He was your manager?
Yeah, 14 years. Well, he's a real, real great guy, not just a manager. You know, in the old days, when I was just getting started, he used to give me everything from clothes to chow. He's a real great guy. Why ain't you married?
Should I be?
Yeah, you're pretty. No, you're not just pretty, you're beautiful. Pretty as a young colt. It's what my old man used to say.
Your father?
Yeah. A girl is as pretty as a young colt. He always used to tell me that.
Go ahead, Mountain.
What, about my father?
Mm-hmm.
Well, he's a nice guy. You know? He's a real big guy, too. I remember one time I was fighting a guy named Jazzo. Yeah, Elmer Jazzo. He looked just like my old man. He was a spitting image. You know, in the first round, I couldn't throw a punch. So in the second round, look, I closed my eyes, I got him in close, and I hooked him.
Mountain.
Yeah.
There isn't much else, is there? Besides fighting.
No, I guess not. I'm sorry.
Don't be. It's just that there's so much else for you that you'll be able to find. Hey, Martin.
Yeah.
Them are violins.
Allstate, the company that cuts red tape and high cost out of insurance, presents Ed Reimers.
Good evening. $1.60 on his auto insurance by switching to Allstate. This much solid cash. And he saved all this money without stepping outside his living room. Now, here's what Mr. Dunsford had been paying for auto insurance that didn't give him all the protection he wanted. $188. And his rates were about to go up. Well, that was just too much. So Mr. Dunsford did a very simple thing. He looked up Allstate in the phone book, dialed the Allstate number, and heard the famous, friendly Allstate greeting.
Allstate, may we help you?
And then Mr. Dunsford said, I'd like to get the facts about Allstate auto insurance. And here are the facts he got. For $142.40, he could buy the same protection from Allstate, plus protection against uninsured motorists now offered by Allstate in most states, plus raising his medical payment limits from $3,000 to $5,000. More protection, and still a cash saving of $45.60. Well, you can see why Mr. Dunsford switched to Allstate. In many states, policyholders are saving as much as 38% compared with the rates charged by most other companies. Allstate saves people money by being modern, cutting red tape. Cutting red tape to pay claims fast, too. So why don't you stop by the Allstate booth at Sears or an Allstate Insurance Center or just call us on the phone. You'll find out why nearly 5,000 people per working day are turning to Allstate for protection. And remember, you're in good hands with Allstate.
It's a regular garden, ain't it?
Where are the flowers?
You're right here.
It's late, Mountain. I've got to go home.
I'll call you a cab.
Grace, I had a real nice time tonight.
I did too.
You know, when we were coming out, I heard Charlie say that I had a pretty date.
Thank Charlie for me.
No, it wasn't that he said you were pretty, it was that he said I had a date. You know, it's like with music. I don't think I ever really had a date before. You know, no, I mean somebody I liked, somebody I wanted to be with.
I think that's a compliment.
You know, one time in St. Louis, Army had a girlfriend, and she had a friend, so Army fixed me up. And they were waiting for us after the fight, you know, waiting outside. And so when we came out, this girl was supposed to be with me. She came running up to me and she...
She what, Mom?
She turned around and she ran away. And she looked at my face and she ran away. Oh, no. Now, that shouldn't have hurt. I know what I look like. I know what I sound like, too. But it did hurt. I didn't want it to happen again, so... So I never let it happen.
A cab, Martin, it's late.
Sure. This one, the cab.
Oh, you remember to think about what I told you. I think you'll like working with children.
Yeah, I'll think about it. I'll think about it a lot. Don't build me up now, Miss Carney. Don't say that I'm anything special. Just tell them that I had 111 fights and that I never took a dive. I'm real proud of that.
Sure you are, Martin. You must be very proud.
Hey, where is he?
He'll be here, Mr. Prelli.
He better be. I ain't got all night.
Yes, sir. Hello. Oh, yeah, Mr. Henson. Yeah, how are you? No, Mr. Henson, I haven't forgotten. That's right. Yeah, I'll have it for you in a couple of weeks. You know, look, Mr. Henson, 3,000... Yeah, sure, Mr. Henson. No, I won't forget. A week from tomorrow. Thanks, Mr. Henson. Thanks a million. Hey, Arnie was looking. I heard you left a bottle with a girl, huh?
Yeah, Mace, I want to tell you all about her. No kidding. She's a wonderful girl.
Some other time, kid. We got a little business to talk over here.
Arnie. It's Miss Carney, the girl from the employment agency.
Oh, she's a pretty kid.
Beautiful. She's a beautiful girl.
How about it, Mace? I ain't got all night.
Yeah, right away. Say, Mom, I want you to meet somebody. This here's Mr. Pirelli. Mr. Pirelli promotes wrestling at the Matthews Arena.
How do you do?
Likewise. So, get with it, Mace.
Oh, yeah. No, listen. Hey, Arnie, I think we've got a great deal here. No kidding. Come here, Mom, will you? Mr. Pirelli, you want to tell him?
Well, there isn't much to tell. Mace here thinks you might be a good draw. Your name's pretty well known. I seen you fight a couple of times myself. Yeah, I think I can line you up with some matches. I think it might be worth both our while.
Well, didn't Mace tell you? I'm not supposed to fight anymore. I don't think I'd give my license back.
No, look, kid, we're not talking about boxing now. Didn't Mr. Prelli tell you? He promotes wrestling matches.
Well, I don't know how to wrestle.
You don't have to know how, kid. A couple hours, you learn all the holes. There's two big things you got to remember in my business, kid. That's how to fake, make it look real, and that's how to land without hurting yourself. That's about it.
I don't get it.
What do you mean you don't get it, kid? Mr. Prelli laid it right out for you, and that ain't all. I got a real funny idea, see? We're going to call you Mountain McClinic, the Mountaineer. And I'm going to get one of the Mountaineer outfits, you know, the black hat with a straw, one of them long squirrel guns, you know? And... Well?
I don't think he goes for it, Mace.
What do you mean he don't go for it? Hey, Mountain, what do you got to say?
Well, Mace, I'd lose your fortune.
I can't wrestle. I wouldn't win a single match.
What are you talking about, win the match? It's a setup. One night you win, the next night the other guy
wins. Depends on who plays the heavy.
Tank job?
Look, will you talk sense? This is an entirely different thing.
Yeah, but I never took a dive for anybody. You know, I had 111 fights. I never took a single dive.
It's like May says, these ain't exactly dives. Well, look, you guys talk it over. Give me a ring, Mace, by tomorrow. I got to know by tomorrow.
Yeah, Mr. Trelly, you make out those contracts. We'll be down to sign them in the morning.
Sure. Nice meeting you, Mountain.
I figure you owe me. How do you figure?
Yeah, I guess I do.
All right, then we won't talk about it no more.
Mace, I was almost a heavyweight champion of the world.
Well, then you just remember that. Remember you was almost heavyweight champion of the world. And I remember I was the guy who managed you.
Oh, look, kid, we'll do this one with our eyes closed. Take him home, will you, Army?
No, never mind, Army. No, I can go home by myself.
Well, he's just upset. He just don't know.
He knows. Believe me, he knows.
Ah, he'll come around.
Sure he will. You'll fix it that way. You've got a knack, Mace. You violin him to death. If that doesn't work, squeeze him a little. Back him up a little. Twist his arm a little for him. What a knack you've got, Mace.
Hey, Army. Stick, will you?
Stick?
You know, help me with him. Just stay alongside.
Oh, partners again, huh? If he sees me, he'll move fast. Is that the idea?
No. I just want to see the both of us there. Don't let him alone. This is a lousy one night.
Say, it ain't bad enough that I have to watch this kid go down all these years. Now you want me in the pit so I can officiate at the burial.
It don't have to be that way, Army.
This kid is a slob to you, Mace. He's a hunk of flesh. He's a has-been. A dead weight. Is that what you call a cross to bear? Listen to me. I'll tell you what he is, Mace, this boy. He's a decent man. He's a man with a heart. He's somebody with flesh and blood. You can't sell this on the market by the pound. Because if you do, Mace, if you do, you'll rot in the gutter for it. Understand me? You'll rot.
Army, be there at least, will you? You know, don't leave him alone.
No, I won't. I can't leave him alone. He'll do it for you even if I'm not there. So I'll be there. Why is it, Mace? Tell me, why is it so many people have to feed off of one guy's misery? Doesn't it... Tell me, Mace, doesn't it make you want to die?
Allstate Insurance can't put a stop to all driving hazards. For example, we can't do anything about the early honker. Nor can we help you with this one. And nothing can stop a blowout whose time has come. But when you need claim service, that's when Allstate can really help. With Allstate, help is as near as the nearest phone. Allstate cuts red tape to give fast claim service. Lots of times we write you a check as soon as we've seen the car. And depending on the state where you live and how you use your car, you may save up to 38% from rates of most other companies. Isn't that right? So see an Allstate agent at your Sears store, Allstate Insurance Center, or just phone us. You're in good hands with Allstate.
This is the CBS Television Network. We now return to Playhouse 90. This half hour brought to you by Camel Cigarettes. Speaking for Camels, James Daly.
This 54-foot catch is a sailor's dream. You can tell by the way she takes the seas, shakes them off, and plunges back for more. Takes a good man at the helm when the Atlantic's this rough. Richard Bertram, yacht broker, is one of the world's best ocean racers. He knows the Atlantic in all her moods, the strength and weakness of boats, the feeling of being your own master with nothing but water beneath and sky above. A man like this wants a real cigarette. That means Camel, the mild smoke that tastes so good and rich. No fads or fancy stuff for Richard Bertram, simply the finest taste in smoking. Why don't you try them? Have a real cigarette. Have a Camel. You'll get more smoking comfort out of Camels. Remember, only top quality tobaccos are good enough for Camel's exclusive blend. So good and mild. The finest taste in smoking.
That's it. Now, that's where you throw them out of the ring.
Gotcha. Say, how about that bit when I do the eye gouging?
Well, that comes after he pulls your beard.
Well, listen, let's try another hole.
I'll get on the table.
All right.
Hey, Mr. Pirelli?
Yeah.
Huh?
Oh! Good. Well, so where is he?
Well, he's on his way, Mr. Pirelli. How's the house?
Well, not bad. They just want action. Don't have to be good action, but it's got to be action. So have your boy move around. Oh, and this is important. You see, when the other guy gets him in a lock or any other kind of hold, have him look in pain. You understand? He's got to look as if he's giving up the ghost. Real pain. Torture. Agony. All right, come on, boys. You're on next. Let's go.
He'll go out there and die for you.
Good. Hey, he better get here soon. It's going to take him a while to get into that outfit.
He'll be here, Mr. Pirelli.
See you later. Yeah. Come on, boy. Go.
Mr. Pirelli.
Eh?
How about the rest of the dough?
They'll be waiting for you after the fight. I don't know how you talk me into an advance. Most people can't.
With me, it's an art.
It must be.
Is that anything to make a fuss over, is it?
I don't have to wear it.
Well, if you did, it'd break your heart, huh? Army.
Go.
You know me, Army.
You bet I do.
I don't mean that way. I mean you know me inside. You know how I hate to do this? I can't sleep nights. It's just eating me out inside. Well, you're late. Come on, we gotta get into this stuff.
Yeah, sure, man, sure. Hey, I look for you. I was afraid you wasn't gonna come.
He's here. Ain't this a lot, kid? Oh, listen, we're gonna kill him. We're gonna just knock him dead. Well, you don't have to keep it on long, kid. You know, you just walk around a ring a couple of times, then you can take it right off. You got these long johns on underneath, see? And then you don't have to put this stuff back on until the bout's over.
Clown.
That's what he thinks. Can't you think of thought for yourself?
It's what I think, too. It's what everybody out there's gonna think. Clown. Mace, don't make me.
What do you mean, don't make you? What, am I your father or something? Don't make you? You don't do anything you don't want to do. If you don't think you owe me, okay.
Mace, how about a couple of pictures? We ain't had any with the costume yet.
Pictures?
All part of the build-up, kid. One picture's worth a million words. That's what the Greeks say. Yeah. Hey, what do you want, him out here or in the hall?
Out in the hall, I think. We got more room.
So? What are you waiting for, Valet?
Valet.
Come on, let's hurry it up.
I'll be right there, Mr. Pirelli.
medics on deck. Let's go!
Mace, tell him to go away.
What do you mean, tell him to go away?
Come on, get your boy out here. The photographer's waiting for him. His match is on.
He'll be right out there, Mr. Prelli. He'll be right there. Listen, you walk out of me now and I'm dead, you understand? I'm dead.
I can't, Mace. I can't.
Debt, mister. You owe me.
Mace.
Listen, you got my life on a line now. I can't afford to let you cross me. I'll beat you to a pulp myself. I wouldn't be in this jam if it wasn't for you.
Mace, I'll do anything you want, but I can't.
It bothers you too much, doesn't it, huh? Well, it didn't bother you last week to stand in the middle of the ring with your hands at your sides and let Gibbons beat you to a pulp for 7 rounds. It didn't bother you a bit, did it? It didn't bother you that I put all my money on you and said you wouldn't go for 3.
Mace? You bet against me? Mace, why did you bet against me?
Would it make any difference, kid? If I hocked my left foot and betted on you, would it make any difference? You're not a winner anymore. There's only one thing left. Make a little on the losing.
Fink? You dirty Fink, Mace? You dirty, lousy Fink? Because I stood out there and I took it for you. I gotta pay for it like this. Like this, huh, Mace? You know, in all the dirty, crummy 14 years I fought for you, I never felt ashamed, Mace. Not one round, not one single minute. And now I feel ashamed. I'd have gone into any ring barehanded against a guy with a cleaver, and that wouldn't have hurt me near as much as this.
Mountain, listen to me, will you?
Army, I'm sorry. Army, I didn't mean it.
Oh,
Army, I'm sorry.
That's all right, Mountain. I rated that.
Oh, dear God.
I rated it, Mountain. I shouldn't have been here.
I'm sorry.
Listen, go, kid. Go. Go and leave.
Did I hurt you?
Take what precious little you've got left and go, will you?
Did I hurt you?
Oh, I'll be all right, Mom. Go.
I'm sorry, Arnie.
Please go, kid, will you? I had it coming to me.
Sorry.
Go. Go, Mom.
Good night, Mom. He's walking out! The boy's walking out! What's with it? You don't want to lose me with this, don't you? You ain't gonna get a license to walk in a dog! You don't think I will, huh? You don't think I will, Mitch? Well, let me tell you, I got 800 people out there slamming their feet down. They want to see a wrestling match! What am I gonna tell them? What am I gonna tell them?
Goodbye, Mom.
All right, Mitch. I'll fix you good. Believe me, I'll fix you good.
Young in years, but old in experience. That's Billy Heft, dependable left-hander of the Detroit Tigers. With 6 major league seasons already under his belt, the experts predict a lot of winning baseball ahead for him. Billy, do you feel extra pressure when a heavy hitter steps up?
No, because you just can't think of the damage a good hitter can do. Any guy up there with a stick in his hand can hurt you.
In other words, you have to respect them all.
That's right. Everyone in that batting order. Even the 220 hitter can have his good day.
On cigarettes, Billy, ever do much switching around?
Not since I hit on Camels.
What puts Camels so far ahead with you?
Mostly their flavor and their mildness.
Remember, the best tobacco makes the best smoke. You'll find that no other cigarette equals the Camel blend of costly tobaccos. That's why Camels taste so rich, smoke so mild. Today, more people smoke Camels than any other brand. How about you? Have a real cigarette. Have a Camel.
His name was Hacker, Charlie Hacker. All you guys are geniuses. Come on, I'll prove it to you. Hey, Ma, you remember Hacker, Charlie Hacker? He never fought Lewis, did he?
No, he never fought Lewis. But he fought me, though.
No kidding, Ma, no kidding. How'd you make out?
Well, he went 3 rounds. You know, he was always strong in the beginning.
Yeah, he was always strong.
So he comes in at me, and he don't box, he never did box, you know. I don't remember. I'm sorry, but I don't remember.
Hey, Charlie, give me a beer.
Sure, man, coming up.
Here I am, miss.
Your army?
That's right. Thanks for coming.
Tell me, what happened?
Well, what happened was he just walked out on a match, and I wanted to make sure that he would keep walking. I didn't want him to stop at that graveyard over there.
How can I help?
You can help by not conning him. He's been conned by experts. He's been riddled. He'll listen to you, miss. When he comes out of there, will you head him towards Grand Central Station? And please, give him this, will you please?
What's that?
That's a train ticket to Kennesaw, Tennessee.
It's home?
It was once. Maybe it'll be again. Do you love him, miss?
I don't know. I feel so sorry for him, though I could cry.
Will you tell him that, miss? Would you please tell him that you think he's a decent man and that you like him, but tell him that for the present that you're not coming with a kiss, because he's been chasing a ghost for so long, and I think the next time that he hungers for something, he ought to get it. It's only fair. Thanks very much, miss. Thank you.
Box is outside.
Comes. I figured.
It's not a payoff, it's a deal.
All got a choice, huh?
You can say no and take a 3-minute beating. Or if you want to agree, well, you know what it means, mate. Start all over again.
Relax, Macy. Little proposition. Mr. Henson's got this boy, wants him trained. Wants a smart pilot. You.
Or...
or somebody will send you flowers in the hospital, Mace.
Kid's good.
Just like the mountain, huh?
Who's the mountain?
Oh, he's just a good, fast kid. He's all hands and feet. Mouth full of teeth. Talk like General Lee. Just like you do. Just like you look. Go on home, kid, and work in a drugstore.
I don't want to work in a drugstore. I want to be a fighter.
All right, then, get this straight. There are only 8 champions. Everybody else are also Rams. There's the good and the bad. The good is great. And the bad stinks. So let's give it a little whirl. Army, you're needed.
Lasinski.
Yeah.
Lasinski. Lasinski's a ballet dancer. He could knock a cherry off a nut sundae.
Did you ever try to hit him? Did you ever try to hit him?
I hit him. In 1942. Or was it 1943? I boxed him in the main going to St. Nicholas Arena, you see. Now, in the third round, he comes out beat, bobbing and weaving, and weaving and bobbing. And then Zowie. I caught him on the side of the head. I nearly tore my thumb off. And then I hit him so hard that his mouthpiece hit some David Nitro and she slapped the guy behind her. Well, anyhow, I took it easy. And then her husband got mad. He lays into the sky as he comes back, you see.
Yeah. Well, what about Lazinski?
He's just a fancy dance. But you should have seen his name throw right. She hit him so hard with the right hand, she didn't know which way it coming.
Who won the fight?
Because I had to go home that night, you see. And I didn't want to stay around all the time. But I remember this girl, hit at the sky with a right, and she didn't know what happened.
Mom!
Thank you.
When you get home, when you get settled, will you write me and tell me what happened?
Well, I'm going there, but I don't even know if it's home anymore.
Well, you go find out. You look for it, Mountain. Maybe it's in Kinescope. Maybe it's working with children. But wherever it is, it's not over there. This is my home address, Mom. Write me.
Thanks for not running away.
Bye, Mom.
Yeah, I was a fighter.
I can tell by your ears. You got big ears.
Yeah, they're cauliflower ears.
Get ears like that? I'd like ears like that.
Jeffrey, don't be rude.
No, that's all right, ma'am. You gotta keep your right hand down like this. Now, take your thumbs out first. You break your hands if you keep your thumbs in. Thumbs out, your hand down here, and put your chin in your shoulder like this. That's pretty good. Now let me see you lead. No, look, you'll never lead with a right hand because somebody come right over it with a left hand.
I hope he's not boring, bothering you.
No, ma'am. I like it.
Where are you heading for?
Home. I'm heading home. Yeah, I don't know how long I'm going to be there. Because I'm coming back. I'm coming back up this way to take a job. I'm going to work with kids like Jeffy here.
Come on, Chip. It's you and me far.
Okay. Now, let me see you throw a right hand. right hand, yeah. Look, let me tell you something. Every time you throw a punch with one hand, you know, you got to keep the other one in position. Everything's got to be just, you know, you throw a left, you keep the right ready to throw. If you throw a right, you keep your left up here, you see? Everything is just right. Now, let me see you throw a left and a right. Go ahead. No, a left and a right. That's pretty good. Come on. Come on now. Go keep throwing. Try to see if you can hit me on the chin. Go ahead. That's pretty good. Go ahead. Come on in close. Go ahead. Go ahead. Hit me on the chin. You don't have to be afraid about hitting me. Keep your hands in place, you know. Like one, two, one, two. You got to keep everything going all the time, you know. Everything in boxing.
And now a word from our alternate sponsor of this portion of the show, Kimberly Clark.
Friends, there's a definite difference in Delcy. 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 Double soft luxury Delcy. There's a definite difference in Delcy. Your family will know right away.
Your family will notice the difference the day you change to two-ply Delcy. The bathroom tissue that's wonderfully soft and strong like Kleenex tissue. That tears off as evenly as this, every time. You like the new larger Delcy roll that lasts longer. Gives you so much more for your money. It comes in pink, yellow, green, blue, and pure white. So buy luxurious Delcy soon in this handy four-roll package. Each roll is individually wrapped to stay fresh and clean on your shelf. Once you try it, you and your family will agree there's a definite difference in Delcy.
Playhouse 90, brought to you tonight by Camel, far and away the world's largest selling cigarette today. Rich in flavor, mild to smoke. Have a real cigarette. Have a Camel. And by your gas company, in cooperation with gas producers, pipeline companies, and gas appliance and equipment manufacturers, who bring the modern miracles of gas service to your home. And by Allstate, the company with more than 4 million policyholders who have discovered that you're in good hands with Allstate. Playhouse 90, the only weekly dramatic hour-and-a-half program in television. Dick Joy speaking. Portions of the preceding program were pre-recorded. Playhouse 90 is a CBS Television Network production. Requiem. for a heavyweight. Directed by Ralph Nelson. Produced by Martin Manulis.
Say, you going out this week, Doc?
Let me see. This is Wednesday. I leave Friday.
Vacation?
Vacation. Retirement. 38 years. I'm the only one to walk out of the ring without wobbling.
38 years
and retiring. 38. Here, give me a swab, will you? My wife says I've been in it so long I ought to write a book. Yeah, who'd buy it?
Yeah, I bet you've seen some good ones, huh, Doc?
Good ones.
Take it easy, kid. Take it easy.
Just rest a minute, then you can take a shower.
No, I'll be all right now. Oh, Lordy, I caught it tonight, Mish. What'd I do wrong?
You aged, kid. That's the trouble, you aged.
What do you mean, aged?
What are you going to do, Mish?
I don't know. Maybe I'll cut my throat.
Something's wrong, isn't it?
Where were you when the lights went out? I just lost a boy. Get with it, Army.
Besides that,
nothing. Oh, you mean that guy out there? I owe him 50 cents for a raffle ticket.
Take it easy. Take it easy. The world didn't end tonight. Remember that. The world didn't end just because you left the ring.
Yeah, go on.
I meant you'd be surprised at the different kinds of openings that come up for...
Cripples. For guys like that?
I didn't mean just that. I meant for people who have special problems.
But I got no special problems. You see, there wasn't any room down on that cheek, but I was almost a heavyweight champion of the world. I'm a big, ugly slob, and I look like a freak, but I was almost a heavy... You know, I'd like to put that down on that piece of paper. This is no punk. This is a guy who is almost a heavyweight champion of the world.